In the last video, I showed off these wireless LEDs, and I said it would be really easy to make your own, so let's give that a go. We'll reverse engineer the LEDs and create our own versions from discrete components. We'll then reverse engineer the driver circuit and build our own version of that, and then we'll see how well it works. Finally, we'll do a cost comparison to see if it was even worth it. We should end up with a complete working DIY equivalent that you can easily build at home. So let's take a look at the LEDs. The actual operation is very simple. They are just a resonant inductor and capacitor circuit with an LED across it. The circuit is tuned to the frequency that is being output by the driver coil. In the previous video, I wired up a couple of wires on each side of the LED and hooked it up to my oscilloscope, and we saw that the circuit is picking up a signal of 217 kHz. The inductor is marked on the bottom 222. That corresponds to a 2.2 mH inductor. Using this inductor value and the frequency the circuit is resonating at, we can work out what the capacitor value should be. Plugging the values of frequency and inductor into this calculator, we get a capacitor value of 244 picofarads. 220 picofarads is the closest standard value. This will give us a resonant frequency of 228 kHz, which is not a perfect match to the 217 kHz, but it is close enough. For the inductor, I've got a couple of options. I have these bare inductors, and I have these heat shrink covered wire wound inductors. If you peel off the heat shrink of a spare inductor, you can see that they really are very similar to the bare inductors. The only difference is the heat shrink. It does look like there is less wire, but it's hard to really tell without taking it completely apart. It's important that you get unshielded wire wound inductors for this project. It's the coils of the wire that will be picking up the transmitted power. And if you don't have coils, or your inductor is shielded, nothing will be picked up. Soldering the capacitor across the inductor wires is pretty simple. I found it easiest to wrap the thinner capacitor leads around the quite thick inductor legs and then solder the joint. I've done this for both inductor options, and if we put them inside the coil, we can measure the induced voltage. The yellow trace is the bare inductor, and the blue trace is the heat shrink wrapped inductor. There's not a lot of difference, and any differences we are seeing could just be due to component tolerances. With both inductors, we are getting a peak-to-peak induced voltage of around 80 volts. Obviously, this does fall off quite quickly as we move the inductors away from the driver coil. Now, of course, you could use other inductor values. Just make sure you calculate the appropriate capacitor value. I suspect that larger inductors may have more turns, which may give you longer range due to the higher induced voltage, but they may also use different core materials, and there may be other trade-offs in terms of parasitic resistance, which will use up some of the energy. Talking of energy, how much current do we actually get? I've placed a 1K resistor across the circuit and measured the voltage across it. The peak positive voltage is just over 2 volts, and the negative voltage is around 3 volts. Positive and negative is just determined by which way up the inductor is. The asymmetry of the signal is interesting and is probably due to how the power coil is being driven. More on that later. Given we have a 1K load, we have a maximum of 2 to 3 milliamps, which is more than enough to drive an LED. The version that I brought from AliExpress only has one LED, so it's really only using half the energy that is being induced in the circuit. So I'm going to solder two LEDs in opposite directions across the circuit, which in theory should give me double the brightness. I've soldered up a bunch of different colours, and they all work amazingly. The different LEDs will have different ranges due to the varying forward voltage requirements for each colour, but they work really well. So that's the LED side of things. What about the driver circuit and coil? Do your projects look like this? Are you tired of dodgy connections causing gremlins and bugs in your circuits? Maybe you should get a PCB from PCBWay. Check out the link in the description. I've got a photo of the PCB and I've marked up the traces. In the previous video, I wasn't really sure what this chip was. Turns out that I was being a bit slow, and it's the XKT001, as marked on the PCB. The large chip is actually a MOSFET. Here's the reverse engineered schematic. It's pretty simple. The XKT001 is outputting 217 kHz on pin 2 and switching the MOSFET on and off. The mark to space ratio is about 40%. The coil and capacitor of the transmitter is connected between the power rail and the drain of this MOSFET and is simply being switched to ground. Here's a trace of the voltage at the drain of the MOSFET along with the signal being applied to the gate. Recreating this circuit is pretty simple. We need an oscillator, a power MOSFET, a gate driver, and a coil of wire with a suitable capacitor. One thing to make sure when you build this circuit is that you do use a logic level MOSFET, as the circuit will be running at 5 volts from a USB supply. You want your MOSFET to be fully turned on when 5 volts is applied to the gate. You'll also need a gate driver to make sure the MOSFET turns on and off quickly. If you try and drive it directly from your MCU, then it probably won't turn fully on in time. Power MOSFETs have a high gate capacitance, so if you try and drive them directly, the switching time can be too slow. You'll also find that a lot of logic level MOSFETs won't fully turn on when using 3.3 volt logic, so a gate driver can be essential. Great Scott has done an excellent video on MOSFET drivers that's definitely worth a watch. For my coil, I'm making one that has the same number of turns and is approximately the same size as the commercial coil. Measuring the inductance of my coil, I get around 5.4 microhenries. The coil from AliExpress comes in at 5.1 microhenries, so it's quite a good match. With the homemade coils, it is quite variable, and you'll probably end up with anything between 4 and 6 microhenries. Plugging my 5.4 microhenry value into the calculator with a 228 kHz resonant frequency, it wants a 90 nanofarad capacitor. So a 68 nanofarad or 100 nanofarad would be suitable. I've ended up using a 68 nanofarad in my circuit after a bit of testing. You can of course try and construct the exact required value, but given I'm building this on breadboard, just being in the right ballpark should be good enough. How much current is actually going through our coil and MOSFET? The current is limited by a couple of things. The first is simply the resistance of the wire making up the coil and any parasitic resistance in the components. I measured my homemade coil at around 0.5 and 1 ohms. If the inductor is fully saturated, then we could have between 5 and 10 amps flowing through the circuit, as the only limit will be the resistance of the coil wire. This makes the pull-down resistor on the MOSFET gate pretty important. If we leave the gate floating, it could easily allow current to flow and we could cook our circuits. Provided we turn the MOSFET off before the inductor is fully saturated, we'll get a lot less current flowing. We can use this formula to work out the current flowing in the inductor after it has been turned on. Assuming we have a 5 microhenry coil, a 40% mark to space ratio at 228 kHz, and our coil and parasitic resistance in the circuit are 1 ohm, the maximum current through our coil should be just under 1.5 amps. Bear in mind, this is just the peak amps. It's not drawing this continuously. The current ramps up to this value while the MOSFET is switched on, and the MOSFET is turned off for 60% of the time. Regular viewers of the channel will know that I have a lot of ESP32s lying around. I'm going to use one of these as my oscillator. It has a PWM output, and you can easily adjust the mark to space ratio on it to tweak your power consumption. It is, however, a 3.3 volt part, so definitely needs a gate driver. Here's the circuit we're going to build. I've added a 20 microfarad capacitor across the power supply to match the circuit from AliExpress. This helps keep the supply stable when the MOSFET is switched on and when the inductor starts to draw a large current. I put this together on breadboard. I've got my ESP32 module and the gate driver chip. I'm using a TC4469, but any suitable gate driver chip will do. This is controlling the gate of my power MOSFET. We've got the coil and the capacitor across the drain and power supply. If we turn it on, our homemade LEDs all turn on. What's more, the LEDs from AliExpress also turn on. The homemade version seems to have performance that matches the professional version. All in all, a pretty good result. At the end of the day, it is a pretty simple circuit, so we should really expect it to work, but it's nice to confirm it. So let's do a price comparison of my DIY LEDs versus the AliExpress version. From AliExpress, I received 18 wired up LEDs along with two driver circuits and coils. To build our DIY LEDs, we need an inductor, a capacitor, and an LED. You can get 600 LEDs on Amazon for around $12, so for 18 LEDs, it costs around 36 cents. Inductors are a bit more expensive. I found a pack of 50 for around $10, so for 18, we need to spend $3.60. You can pick up a box of 840 capacitors for under $20, so the bill for our capacitors is around 50 cents. so total cost of the LED portion of our project would come in at about $4.50, with the inductors being the majority of the cost. For the driver, we need a power MOSFET. These come in at around $1.20, and we also need a gate driver. I'm using a fairly expensive chip, the TC4469, which comes in at around $5, but there's alternative driver ICs that cost around $1. I'm going to assume that you have a handy MCU to provide the oscillator. So long as it can do 220 kHz or so, you should be okay. If you want to build an oscillator yourself, that's probably an extra couple of dollars on top. To make the two driver circuits, you need double the components, so we're looking at around $4. So I think the total cost of this project is around $8 to $10 to build it yourself, depending on how cheaply you can source components and what you already have lying around. The cost from AliExpress was $19.38. Once taxes and shipping were added, the total was $28.83. The AliExpress version does come with quite nice compact LEDs that might be quite hard to recreate in a home workshop, and you get a couple of nice coils and driver circuits. Let me know what you think in the comments.